to what roles to take on, what activities and problems, rather than people who have no relationship as working councillors. I think they need to be followed through on that suggestion. You may disagree with me, but it was raised at the meeting. Yeah, but former councillors.
Councillors are previous people being councillors to be objective or, whatever.
Well,
said or whatever, so yeah, I disagree. So,
yeah, you may disagree, but it was in the minutes on page 3, and it did raise it, so I'm asking if
and
I accept
that. Councillor Advocate, I can offer an update in terms of where we're at. Obviously, time and distance does assist us in terms of the members with the council. Obviously, as time progresses, former members there will be the opportunity to engage with us in various roles. What I would say is we do work closely with our partners and other authorities who similarly are looking for panel representatives. So there's very good opportunity for example, Hazel and Alan to actually be engaged with other authorities. So there's more of a separation and perception by doing that. And equally, we can take on board the knowledge and skills of former members from those areas. So there's cross-seeding in terms of knowledge and skills.
So your guidance is, whilst people have been approached, there are the threshold is years.
At least a year.
Out of office. Fine, well that's helpful for us to know. Maybe we can think of it all.
I'm just confused
that.
I wasn't at that meeting, so I don't actually know what context is at all.
What we're dealing with is over members or allowances. There's not requirements under the legislation for us to establish a panel. And there's also a requirement to have independent persons on that panel. Those persons also double up and involve dealing with complaints about members, which is why for the secondary role, time and distance and separation is key, given individuals' prior association with political groups and the perceptions of themselves as councillors being subject to complaint procedures, and indeed the wider public perception of the independence of that process. In terms of allowances, the point raised by Joe is equally valid as well. Which is why, obviously, we look to bring in independent persons from a range of backgrounds and sectors, so we have a general and widespread of knowledge and experience, and diversity indeed. But equally, former members from across the city region do have skills and knowledge which are transferable to our area, which actually their knowledge of local authorities is beneficial. So we do engage with them when necessary.
We've also, just to be helpful as well, we've had senior members of the local branch, the Institute of Personal Management, sit on it because that's part of their skill set. And I was just suggesting, Wells, we've had a lot of people from IPE, Institute of Personal Management, and the voluntary sectors. They won't have had working experience as councillors. Therefore, could we introduce some provision to balance the experience that someone on review panel, where we've had formerly long-serving, long-experienced councillors. Just two personal suggestions. So I think it might have been helpful by suggesting there's a year's threshold between service as council and service members on the panel. So that answers my question.
Okay. Move on to item 3, Street Trading Committee proposed revision to terms of reference and delegation. Can I refer members to page 7 to 11 of the agenda, which sets out the details of proposed revisions to part 3 and 2 of the Constitution, which deals with council functions. The report proposes some changes to delegation by granting additional powers to officers on administrative matters relating to street trading. The proposed changes have been considered and endorsed by the Street Trading Committee. Mike's going to give us a bit of an overview of the report.
I think it's important for members to understand the background steps which have taken to get this report at this stage, and also to be clear on what this report does and doesn't mean. In practice, what it means is it does not change members' role in making the decision on these applications. So that does not change. What this does is respond to concerns raised by the Street Trading Committee itself, who asked us to examine an issue in terms of what administrative activities associated with the process could be determined by officers rather than requiring the committee to meet at each stage. On determination of an application, it's certain administrative steps should be dealt by the city manager. So that's what this was seeking. So this has been...
Is this an example that you find from administrative steps?
Essentially what you have is the various iterations towards an application being granted and various thresholds whereby we gather officers will be reported on a regular basis to the committee and be the subject of essentially call in by the committee to revert the matter to the committee. So that's a backup position for you. Got an answer?
Yeah, I mean, as a former chair of Street Training, some of the stuff that arrived at the Street Training Committee should be dealt with by us.
Yeah.
Clearly, it's sort of the minor stuff and the paperwork stuff and all that kind of stuff. In the Street Trader will always get ahead with the committee if they feel what's happened is otherwise. That's the next of these deals. They are strangely independent people. Extremely independent.
Entrepreneurial.
They know what strings to pull if they don't believe, and whose strings to pull if they don't believe they're being seated in a very appropriate manner. So anything that saves the committee and some stuff that I used to have to plow through, since you start plowing through in there. you know, so you think, why is it to be done so good?
Yeah.
So yeah, I support the constitutional chairship.
What this report also offers the opportunity to do is for the next few months for us to try this particular approach, see if there's any issues and address those, and when we come to the annual general
meeting, then we have to say, I don't know what happens to do, because when I walk through town, I'm not the Street Saving the CD Road, so reach the pros, come back, but actually not late one. I just wonder why we're paying off to someone in our city.
You appreciate Councillor Hanson, I can't comment directly on that, and I would offer the comment that the City Council is severely constrained in terms of our available resources, and we direct those as appropriate as best as available.
Matters have been highlighted to me by officers have been raised by members. The first relates to concerns raised by Councillor Radford as regards compliance with the member officer protocol, specifically as regards the requirement to notify and invite all councillors to events organised by the City Council within their respective wards. The second is from Councillor Laura Robertson Collins, commenting that the nature and extent of question time at select committees be reviewed. Councillor Radford, do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, without dragging it out, I made protests when we did this last review of the staff protocol. It hasn't been adhered to for a number of times. And then within 3 months of us having that debate, if I've been quite truthful, closed down on us when we complained about the details. We have an instance where a public social services hub is reopened in Tubert Ward, and the three ward councillors for Tubert were not invited. And questions as to why we weren't invited, apart from an apology, well, apologies means this is a public event taking place in our ward, it's already happened. An apology doesn't count for anything. What I want to know is why we weren't invited and what corrective steps have taken to ensure it won't happen again. This has only happened for 33 years, so as a Christian, I believe I do believe in miracles, but I'd like to see some happening with the staff protocols that all the members of all parties are treated equitably.
But the
proof of the evidence isn't that it isn't the case. I imagine in public event buildings are open in wards by the Ridley administration, and it was certainly true when the Lib Dems were there, there would be a selectiveness as to who was invited. And I'd also be truthful, I think it's not acceptable, and if respect's been asked for, then respect includes all members of all parties having their rights. When there's a housing bit, there's a visit by council officers in a public way, they should be invited. When there's an opening of a public function with a press criteria, the AMR press department supported, all party members should be invited, not those just of the ruling group. And it doesn't happen, it doesn't matter if it's the Labour group ruling, the Lib Dems, it should be consistent. Now, why has it still been a problem after 33 years? I'm astounded.
I am
shocked at the fact that you there.
Carry on that.
Thank you, Chair. I was going to ask a question because it's, within Picton we've had events, or we've heard of events and we would invite it, but was it a council event? Because that's the other thing we need to. So if we're looking at having a protocol or the compliance, it needs to be, is it a council event? Are the officers organising? If not, because sometimes if it's private, because we do know Councillor Radford, sometimes private organisations prefer to have different political groups there and would, I wouldn't say intentionally, but sometimes forget to invite certain councillors. So that's a question going forward. We need to find out whether or not it's an officer event, if it's a cabinet member event, or if it's a community organisation event, and what protocol we use.
The protocols are quite clear. It's not a case of the need for protocols clear. The protocols are clear and were clear before the last review. If council officers are attending a public event, they should notify all members. It's not up just the private organisation. A private meeting is a private meeting. A public event is a public event. In the case I'm complaining about, it's a public launch, a press launch by the mayor, launching a new facility run by the council in conjunction, commissioned by the health service. So it is a public sector event at every stage. There shouldn't be any ambiguity. Now, can I make it quite clear? I've offered, some of our officers may be confused by world maps, we gladly give people free map reading classes. And having served in the RAF, it's helpful to borrow the information. And if they don't know the world maps, we gladly offer if that's a problem. But why should it, in a clear-cut case like this, it should ever have happened?
Councillor Radford's character was a mistake. The Chief Executive issued an instruction to the Chief Executive Management Team and the work protocol was reissued. The work protocol was drafted, I think we agreed it before the last year, as in the last municipal year, just to beef up the terms around ward events. And on this occasion, unfortunately, the requirements were in birth. Councillor Radford was written down there too, but it was a mistake.
And the council about the received apology?
I received an apology, but the apology is worthless. To be honest, it's a public event that's undermined by the rules of all members.
I think if somebody from council put their hands up, say we made a apology, that should be
I think there's a difference when someone says what the error, who and who did the error. The chief executive has replied to the council. We shouldn't even have this debate. What I don't know is why the mistake was made. An apology from the current chief executive, well, I've got apologies going back 33 years. What I'm concerned about and hasn't been answered is why the mistake was made. Was it intentional, or was it the person didn't understand the maps? Because we're glad to give map reading classes to officers.
I think the clue was in the response from the officer. Sorry. The clue was in the response from the officer. It was a mistake.
Well, I don't know that. And that's what I would like to know why the mistake was made. Was it someone didn't realise the protocol was there? Because if the protocol isn't for
you, you're
obviously
a Councillor Radford,
you spoke.
Councillor Nicholas.
Thank you, Chair. It's 2020, and I do appreciate it's going back 33 years, but it's a new year.
It was this year. It happened.
It happened this year, but you mentioned it's been going on for 33 years. So if 2020, if we try and move on, and obviously the Chief Exec, there's an apology, we look at strengthening that in terms of protocol, that's the only way we can make improvement.
How's it going to be strengthened if we don't know why the mistake was made?
Yes. Okay, can I move the for both?
Explain what happened? I did do some investigation into this matter following your previous complaints to the Chief Executive, and I confirmed that the mistake made was quite a simple administrative one. The contact details for all the attendees at the particular event, including the World Council, these were transposed from an Excel spreadsheet onto the Apple email system by being sent by a member of staff who wasn't familiar working with the local World Councils. Unfortunately, a number of names were omitted. And on this occasion, that included the World Councils. A member of staff was spoken to since that event and reminded of the obligations of the protocol and the importance of ensuring that email distribution lists are checked thoroughly before they are used. That's the actual factual account of what occurred.
It would have been helpful to be advised a little bit earlier this time.
Thank you. may be necessary to be submitted to the next meeting of this committee for consideration. Is that agreed?
Yeah. Can I ask one other extra item to that that follows on, which has been a beef of concern, but not I've got not given any examples. We've also had the situation where officers and or without a cabinet member have gone into wards and not advised ward members. Now I think whilst the officers are under clear obligation, the protocols made that clear, but that's applied to a different debate. What I don't think is clear, and it has caused some problems, we've had cabinet members visiting some wards and advising some ward members selectively when they've done a ward visit. Now if they're representing the council, they're not representing a political party, they're paid for by the council, they should be advising all the ward members, not selectively. I think we need some clarity on that. Particularly, I'm going to be honest, I had to have a verbal day to take with one lead member, but he actually suggested how that organisation he visited, which was a public institution, an older people's home, should apply for neighbourhood grants that could be committed for a function, which I have to say, for a private company, I didn't think was appropriate. Now, we had that debate, and the Jen said he wouldn't tell us in the future. But it does cause problems if cabinet members are going into others' wards and not telling the ward councillors. They're not representing the Labour Party, they're representing the council, and they should have a courtesy to all the councillors. I'd like to see where that's clarified or firmed up on the protocols, because I think they may, whilst it's clear on the obligation of officers, it's not clear on the obligation of cabinet members. And it does cause grievances.
Okay.
And if you want respect, it's got to cover both ways.
Councillor Cushman.
I just think that we do need clarity on it, because my view of the cabinet member's role and the officer's role is clearly defined. A cabinet member's role is a political role, and an officer's role is a council role. So I'm not sure that when we do go, or when cabinet members go to different wards, they represent the political party.
They're not representing the council as an institution, they're paid for the council, they're not paid. I'll put it this way, council policy is something that's common, and it's a good debate to have to, I appreciate your honesty, but they're not representing a political party, as in, I'll just talk to, if they're going to invite the Labour member in the ward where there's mixed wards, they shouldn't invite the opposition members. And I say that because they're representing the council, they're not representing the Labour Party and a political party. If not, it shouldn't be covered by council. They can do that as an individual, not as a cabinet member. And we have had election times, but they're not claiming expenses. But if they're claiming off the council expenses, that's my moral view, then they should be representing and respecting all the councillors, including ones who may not take their point of view, particularly when they're talking about the application of council policies in that ward. It's something that affects all the councillors. When we on the planning committee sit, where there is a quasi-judicial function, we've got to treat all the objectors and applicants equitably. And in the same way, you're not representing the Labour Party as a cabinet member, you're representing the City Council. The majority happens to be Labour at the moment. The majority may happen to be something else or different. We have had councils where there's a balanced council, or even very close to that. But they're representing everybody, not just talking to those people of our own persuasion. Because you're carrying out a public function at public. The question is, a public function at public expense.
But in terms of public expense, will you talk about the money that we see to be a councillor?
All travel expenses. Yep.
Because in terms of expenses, you don't get expenses to go to a public event, do you? None of us do.
No, none of us do.
None of us get expenses.
I assume that it's the only public.
And that's my point about clarity. So in my mind, when I'm out, just as an example, as the chair for
education
for culture,
yeah.
Would I be representing council, or would I be representing the Labour group?
That would be my suggestion, certainly, that picking up on the comments from members, not just those present tonight, but in the wider cohort. council. The suggestion will be to pick up a guide and sort of develop that, set up examples of the different roles members have and in what circumstances business may be undertook and how that is influenced by the protocol and what requirements that places on officers. So that I think should pick up all the
points. Yeah, I think it's some clarity either.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I move therefore that both of the above matters, officers be required to prepare reports addressing such issues, including any proposed revisions to the constitution or guidance as may be necessary, be submitted to the next meeting of this committee for consideration. Is that agreed?
Agreed. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.